Good evening. Welcome, everyone. My name is Billy Weitzer. I'm the executive director of the Leo Baeck Institute, and I want to welcome you to the Center for Jewish History. A special thanks to Joan Adler, the executive director of the Straus Historical Society, who keeps that organization running. And she was integral to putting together tonight's event. There are also many members of the board of the Straus Historical Society, including myself, and you'll hear about them as we move on. There are many anniversaries tonight, and unfortunately, one of the new anniversaries, this will be a date remembered for the fire at Notre Dame, who those of you have not heard, but that will get added to the Titanic and to Tax Day, I guess, is making this a Memorial Day. And we're also commemorating, even though it happened in the fall, the 20th anniversary of the Straus Historical Society, at least is becoming a 501c3, which was kind of the motivation for putting together this event, which is co-sponsored by the Straus Historical Society, the Leo Baeck Institute, and the American Jewish Historical Society, whose first president was Oscar Straus. I will be back to introduce our speaker and panel, but first I want to turn the event over to the chairman of the board of the Straus Historical Society, David Kurzman.
Good evening, everyone, and thank you for coming. It means a lot to me, our family, and our friends. My name is David Kurzman. I am the great-great-grandson of Isidor Straus. I'm joined by my father, the great-grandson of Isidor Straus, Paul Kurzman, who you'll have the pleasure of hearing in our panel discussion in a little bit. I want to take a moment just to thank the Leo Baeck Institute and the American Jewish Historical Society for hosting this event. This has been a great partnership. We love having Leo Baeck and Billy Weitzer on the board, recently joined, and the additions have been innumerable. I also want to remind everyone, if you do have a cell phone, don't be afraid to turn it off. Now might be a good time. Also at the end, if you would like to use the elevator, I believe there will be an elevator available to help get people back up. We'll remind you when we get to the end of the program. Finally, if anybody's interested in learning more about the Straus Historical Society, either as purely informational, either to donate or to be, if you have interest in working with the Straus Historical Society in some way, we always welcome volunteers as well as potential board members. So do find one of the board members or myself afterwards. And finally, I'd like to relate that I met earlier a nice woman here by the name of Viv, who showed me a wonderful pin that was given by Ida Straus, Ida Blund Straus, to her mother many years ago. And, I'm sorry? Grandmother, excuse me. And she even has a photograph of her grandmother wearing the pin. She was kind enough to wear it tonight. So do seek out Viv and take a look at the pin. Absolutely stunning. So let me quickly hand off the mic to a colleague and fellow board member, Al Berr, who's going to give us a little introduction and a quick talk about the Straus Park, about 106th Street and Broadway here in New York. And, oh, right, I forgot. I forgot to mention one thing. Some of you may know that we have started last year a scholarship for graduate students in public policy and public affairs. We awarded our first scholarship last year to a wonderful candidate by the name of Rachel King. We will be awarding our second scholarship this year, and due to the generous donation by Oscar Straus Schaefer, we have brought on a second awardee scholarship for this year, so we'll be able to put out two $5,000 awards. So thank you, Oscar Schaefer, and thank you to the board. Albert.
Thanks, David. I'm here to talk about Straus Park, but I do want to mention that I I'm also on the scholarship committee of the Straus Historical Society, and I want to point out in the audience Richard Gerstmann, who's also on the scholarship committee, and Liza Loop. Can you do that? Well, Liza, where are you? Thank you to both of you. Okay, a short history of Straus Park. Most New Yorkers know that as Broadway works its way north, it veers westward. And only some New Yorkers know that at 107th Street, it cuts off West End Avenue, thereby forming a right angle triangle, one block long. In the 19th century, in the 19th century, it was called Bloomingdale Square, which has nothing to do with the other department store, but it had to do with the old Dutch name for the area. As a matter of fact, Bloomingdale School of Music is still located there. After Titanic, the city fathers decided to turn it into a park in honor of Isidor and Ida Straus. He had been a congressman who was well known and highly respected, of course. The location was very appropriate because the Strauses lived at Broadway and 105th Street in a three-story Italianate Victorian house fronting a lawn. Let me see if I can find that. Like that. Like that. Like that. Can you imagine that? At 105th Street, what you're looking at is the, let me think, northeast corner of 105th Street and West End Avenue. Can't imagine that being there. In those days, it was not only uptown, it was almost out of town. So, the contest was held for the design of the park, and the architect Everett Tracy won, and the sculptor was Augustus Lukman, L-U-K-M-A-N. Lukman used the model Audrey Munson for his statue, which he called Memory, and this is the statue. Munson was very well known as a model, and her image can be seen even today, and the statue is in Columbus Circle, atop the municipal building, which is on Chambers Street, the very end of Chambers Street, and in front of the Plaza Hotel, the Pulitzer Fountain. The dedication of the park was held on April 15, this is the photo of that, April 15, 1915, 3 years to the day after Titanic. Titanic sunk in 1912. It was a grand celebration attended by the mayor and many city officials, including a band, and the band is at the bottom of this photo. Okay. The park proved to be a very popular neighborhood fixture for the following decades. However, by the 1980s, 1990s, this photo I think is in the 30s, like 1935, right. The tireless efforts of Leon Auerbach and the 106th Street Block Association convinced the city to restore the park and redesign it by widening it and reducing West End Avenue to one way for that block. The rededication was on April 15, 1997. I think this is Adrian Benepe, who was at one time the head of the Parks Department, isn't that right? Yeah, right. And there's the park and the flowers. Joe Arbo, are you still here? Raise your hand, he's our gardener, and he's responsible for the beauty of the park. And the rededication was on April 15, 1997. You see Brett Gladstone, great-great-grandson of Isidor and Ida, who spoke and spoke very well. Spring plantings. And this is a photo of an art in the park. Every fall, we have a full day celebration of the park, of the Strauses, and we have a local artists who have their paintings and their photographs for sale. This is one of our board members who is a Titanic nut. Excuse me, I mean aficionado, thank you very much. And he has lots of Titanic memorabilia, and we're grateful for him. Here's another picture of memory. Another picture of memory. End of slideshow. Behind the statue in the park is a granite bench inscribed with a phrase from the Book of Samuel, which reads, "Lovely and pleasant were they in their lives, and in their death they were not divided." Straus Park stands as a living and loving memory to the Strauses, Isidor and Ida. So come and visit us when you're in the neighborhood. Thank you.
Thank you, Al, and thank you, David. As I'm sure most of you know, the Leo Baeck Institute is dedicated to preserving German Jewish history through our library and archive that's located here. We tell the stories of German-speaking Jewry over the last five centuries, both the vibrant aspects and the difficult times, including more recent years. Following the history of individuals from Germany to the United States and back sometimes to Germany is also a part of our charge that we share with the American Jewish Historical Society. And naturally tonight fits with that theme. As you can read in the program, Isidor Straus came to the US from Germany in 1845, although only 9 years at that time, 9 years old. We all can examine what combination of culture and experiences from Germany, from the United States, from a Jewish family, influenced his prominent life. We're going to hear a lecture about the Straus family and the impact of the Titanic, which is memorialized by the park, from Michael Lisicky. Michael's day job is as an oboist with the Baltimore Symphony, as you can read in the program. But I've heard him speak, and I know that you'll find him very interesting and insightful as he talks about department store history. After he speaks, he and I will be joined on the panel by Paul Kurzman. You can also read in the program about Paul. He's on the board of the Straus Historical Society and is a professor of social work at CUNY and Hunter College. After the speaker and panel, please join us for refreshments in the Great Hall. And if you haven't already, enjoy the pop-up exhibit that was put together by many people, including Lauren Paustian from the Leo Baeck Institute, as well as Warren Klein from Temple Emmanuel, who also serves on the Straus Historical Society Board. So, Michael, will you join us?
Thank you, Billy. Thank you, Joan. Thank you, everybody here at the Leo Baeck Institute that brought me here on this important day and this important anniversary. I guess it's fair to say that I am Michael Lisicky and I am a department store nut. Or I guess we change it to aficionado, as we just heard. I am a musician with the Baltimore Symphony. I grew up in South Jersey, and I really can't explain what motivates me with department stores, but since 2009, I've written 10 books on department store histories, and I'm just fascinated by the roles they played in our communities, in our lives, and how generations worked there and grew up there, shopped there. They seemed like they were such permanent institutions. And as I learned, especially unfortunately or fortunately, being in the last year of the baby boomer generations, this is something that I saw go away. And I couldn't believe it. And when I tried to realize, well, what is my passion behind department stores, I realized after many years, it was the time that I spent with my mother, because that's what my mother knew. And I hear too many stories of people traveling on streetcars, putting on the gloves, spending time with their mother and grandmother. My mother didn't have any daughters. She had me and a couple other boys, and we were in a station wagon, and we were driving to places like Allentown, Trenton, Wilmington, and Baltimore, going to places that she liked, and that was department stores. So when what happened was, I mean, I loved how everything was different. And I'm gonna jump ahead two slides, because this was the third book that I wrote. It was a book on gimbals. Does Macy's tell gimbals, but nobody undersells gimbals. Gimbals is a part of this lecture in many different ways. It's the third book that I wrote. I had this hidden little passion on department stores that made its way onto the internet back in 2008 in an Ask the Expert column. You can all be experts. It doesn't take a degree or anything. But I had questions regarding histories of these stores. And when somebody found out, a publisher found out, they said, well, how would you like to write a book about Filenes? I went to school in Boston. I went to New England Conservatory. And I was like, well, everyone kept telling me to write a book. I don't want to write a book. I want to read one. So I said, no, thank you, after thinking about it with my wife and a couple weeks. I said, it'd be different if it was a book about hustlers in Baltimore, because I lived in Baltimore and I knew where that research material was. So what happened was they called back in 2 weeks, how'd you like to write a book about hustlers? And I did, it in 3 months' time, and I didn't realize I was going to outsell Danielle Steele for about a week, and also outsell the Mark Twain book, and I had to go through 6 printings just to make through the holiday 2009 season. People loved these places, and there's a reason for it. It's a reason, the social, the economic, and the people that were behind these businesses, which you're going to hear about, of course, here with the Straus. And I have to also congratulate everybody here at the Straus Historical Society for 20 years. And that's especially wonderful to be part of that celebration. But this is the book that brought me here, because this is book number 10. And I never quite understood. I mean, yes, I'm a department store nut. I admitted it. But what is the Straus in Abraham and Straus? Because if you are a department store nut, you know that Macy's is Straus, Macy's, or vice versa. Yes, Miracle on 34th Street. You know, they had Mr. Macy and Mr. Gimbals that was all in there going, even though there wasn't a Mr. Macy. There was Mr. Bernard Gimble even auditioned for his own spot in the movie and got turned down because he didn't fit the character they were looking for. But there wasn't a Mr. Macy. It was a Mr. Straus that was one of many that was running that business. But Mr. Macy, who passed away in 1877, which kind of was a real changing point to the company, that's what kind of piqued my curiosity. And when Gimbals, oh, there's a few other books. When Gimbals, let me just finish with Gimbals for a second, because I thought in 1986, when Gimbals, the owner of Gimbals, says, we're going to close unless we don't find an owner. And that was in January of 86, and it seemed like Gimbals isn't going to close. We've all heard threats before, and we keep hearing threats of everything today. And I didn't believe that Gimbals was going to close, but Gimbals closed in June 1986, and that's why I had to find out this information. And remember, I am an oboist in the Baltimore Symphony. That's been my life as an oboist. I've been so since 1975. This is just a passion. And what I wanted to do, and what I'm trying to do tonight, is I have a limited amount of time to go through about 150 years of fun dealing with department stores and Macy's, the beginning, and also where it went from there. Now, I know we're at the Leo Baeck Institute, and I'm honored to be here, but we have to start from the very beginning, and I'll roll through it a little bit, because it all started with Roland Hussey Macy, who was born in 1822, and he was not German, he was not Jewish, he was from Nantucket, and he was a Quaker. And it's not, and that's a little bit unlike many of the businesses that are around this country. Many were founded by German Jewish peddlers. Go back to Gimbals. Adam made his way up the Mississippi before he settled in Vincennes, Indiana, because that was the next new metropolis in the world until the railroad decided not to go there. But Macy, Here he is. His big story is at the age of 15, he goes on a whaling expedition because he's out there, lives in Nantucket. It's a 4-year whaling expedition. And this is where he amasses his money. And at one point, there's a storm, a big hurricane, as it says. And we all know what the Macy's, what that symbol, what it is today, and how it's been with the red star. And his big comment was, when the sky broke, a bright red star appeared. Look, we'll lay our course by that red star and hold it. And made it safely back to land. That's why Roland put the red star tattoo on his arm. Roland then went to work in Boston and worked for what seemed to be his future father-in-law. Didn't like working there. Then he left the following year in 1849 to California. He was going to sell for the silver miners because they needed business out there. That didn't work out. He came back to Massachusetts and he opened, well, we see right, oh, there's a star. What you see on the right, a Haverhill Cheap House, which is north of Boston. Yeah, seemed like a great idea because Macy was going to buy and sell for cash, which is a practice that the Strauses even tried to keep going after they acquired the business or took over the business. And but it wasn't successful because they were too competitive. People were too devoted to the people that were to the owners of these businesses, and with by 1855 Macy had to file for bankruptcy, and there's a ledger that it has like when he filed for bankruptcy, I have worked for nothing, damn. So then he goes out to Wisconsin, gets involved in some land deals, and comes back to New York. And on October 27th, well, here's his star logo. And there you'll find that as on October 27th, 1858, he opens up that fancy goods shop at 14th and 6th Avenue, which is becomes the first Macy's store. His concept is on fixed prices, low prices, sell for cash, and a vigorous advertising. Fixed prices and customer satisfaction, that was a rarity in 1858. He wasn't the only one to do that. And here is the opening ad there. He expanded to 11 storefronts over 20 years. It was an important business. It was a big business and flourishing business. And I mean, he really wanted to wish it to keep the Macy company in the family. And he really had hoped to pass it on to R.H. Macy Jr., his son. But unfortunately, his son had quite a drinking problem. So he took on a couple partners, Abel LaForge and Robert Valentine. And what they did in 1875, it was decided they would take over the business should Macy die. 1877, Macy passes away on a European trip, and control of the business goes to LaForge and Valentine. Now the son realizes he has been left out of the will, and he writes in the will, I'm compelled to acknowledge the failure of every effort made by me to stop his passion for drink. And we go through this consistent name changes, these ownership changes. Where at one point the R.H. Macy name was going to go to LaForge and Valentine, who were running the store at that point. And then they passed away, and a circle happens. And then on St. Patrick's Day, 1874, Nathan Straus walks into R.H. Macy with two porcelain plates under his arm, as the story goes. Now, that's kind of where things are. 1874 is when we see the Straus family make its first appearance into R.H. Macy. Now, let's go back to what we know with Lazarus Straus. Now, I cannot sit here or stand here and give you the entire family tree. And I remember when I did that book in Hutzler's in Baltimore, I asked Bunny Hutzler, who is 100 years old. I asked her, what did you think of the book? And she said, well, you didn't talk enough about the family. And I said, well, I wanted to concentrate on the business. And she said, but you didn't know any better. So, I mean, you can, and that's fine, because it's Bunny Hutzler. I'm a musician in the symphony. I'm talking to Bunny Hutzler. So, Lazarus. Let's kind of go through this. Lazarus emigrates to the United States in 1852. They say, the New York Times says he comes from the best Jewish stock in Germany. And he peddled in South Georgia. As I said, Gimbel worked his way in New Orleans. Lazarus Straus went to South Georgia and ended up settling in the West Georgia community of Talbot County. And in 1854, that's when he establishes his business. These are all stock images that came from the R.H. Macy Corporation back in 1927. Of course, they're drawings. And at that point in 1854, he does call for his wife and three sons and daughter to come join him in Georgia. And the sons, they describe him as barefooted, happy-go-lucky country youths. It's hard to think of that and to think of the Straus family and where they became. But another statement was that in Georgia, Lazarus instilled in their minds the precepts which developed all three sons into international figures in the world of commerce, finance, and diplomacy. And that is a pretty tall order to have there. Now, they did eventually move to Columbus, Georgia. There is a real wave of anti-Semitism during the time prior, especially and during the Civil War. So in 1860, they moved the business from Talbotton to Columbus. Columbus, even though Lazarus keeps teaching the Hebrew education at home and instilling that culture, the three boys, are attending Methodist and Baptist Sunday schools just to keep religion. Now the boys, Isidor, Nathan, Oscar, in that order. You can find older information and that will put them out of order. Isidor, Nathan, Oscar. And they really become the backbone of the Straus family. Now, Oscar is much younger. Here's the three boys here, the three sons. Oscar is younger than the other two, and I will not concentrate or mention him much in the talk because there's very little of his involvement that was in the Macy organization. Now it's Isidor. Isidor kind of becomes Lazarus's right-hand man, and we've heard Isidor. You're gonna look at all the displays out there. Isidor, who really was the driving force, especially with the three boys in the terms of commerce and retail. He wanted to thought about going to West Point. That did not pan out. But instead, here he is in Columbus, Georgia, and he decides to become, as the best way to put it, a Confederate commercial agent, where he helps trade between the South and also in Europe, because there is a trade, they need goods. He was still being loyal to where he was living. But he amassed some money, and Lazarus decided he needed to leave Georgia. He wanted to leave Georgia because, first of all, Confederate money wasn't worth much, and also it was going to take the South too long to recover. So Isidor suggests they move to Philadelphia. Isidor has him move to New York instead, seeing that that is more the place. Here's the two sons there, as younger pictures, with Isidor on the left and Nathan on the right. To talk about the two, when I started working with the Abraham and Straus book, I really needed to find out, what were the Strauses? Who were the Strauses? And I mean, Oscar was such an important figure, especially as a lawyer. He went to Columbus Law School and then became such a politician in the end, which I'll bring up in a bit. But 1887, Grover Cleveland, and nominates minister to Turkey. 1906, Secretary of Commerce and Labor. He's the first Jewish cabinet member of the U.S. government and was a gubernatorial candidate in 1912. But as far as in the purpose of this conversation, I'm going to go to this shot because this is L. Straus. That's Lazarus Straus. That is the firm that is set up here in 1866 when the Straus family comes to New York. And they deal in porcelain, crockery, and china. And that is the business that sets them forward. It first was L. Straus and Son, and then it becomes L. Straus and Sons, as Nathan then joins the business. I want to talk a little bit about Isidor and Nathan, because there's a lot of times where brothers or business counterparts, they have different personalities, yet they work together and complement each other. This is what they talk about Isidor. Three definitions: confident, dignified, reliable. Nathan, enthusiastic, gregarious, and popular. Isidor, peaceful. Nathan, volatile. And Isidor, comfortable behind a desk. Nathan couldn't sit still. Isidor, leader, merchant, especially liked being in charge. Nathan didn't enjoy sales. He wanted to establish a shop. As I said, and here's actually, I'm gonna talk about the crockery business. And there's a shot there, and we have some great examples out there in the lobby. 1874, you have L. Straus and the father and the two boys running that organization, and it becomes one of the largest China operations in the country at that time. They're doing business with Wanamaker's, Strawbridge's in Philadelphia, Jordan Marsh in Boston, and Wexler and Abraham in Brooklyn. I mean, it becomes a real powerhouse, and they established that business in the basement of Macy's in 1874, and it becomes such a showplace even for the company. And as Macy's was kind of going through all these ownership changes, it got to the point with Charles Webster, who had control by himself at one point, in 1888, needed partners. So what did he do when he looked for partners and people to invest? He looked downstairs, and he looked at Isidor and Nathan Straus. And at that point, he sold Isidor and Nathan 45% of the business, I believe, for $1.6 million, with the stipulation that Isidor goes into the management and runs the business. Nathan always did play some of a role, but Nathan was also a people person, and he had some real passions. I mean, one passion if you're a Straus or know anything about the Straus family, but the pasteurized milk. He saw so many young children who were ill at an early age and felt that it was from bad milk. And he set up these pasteurized milk stations throughout the city in order to alleviate this large infant death rate, which he felt was from that milk supply. He also takes many of his passions and really becomes this amazing philanthropist, both here in New York and over in Jerusalem, trying to fight tuberculosis, soup kitchens, malaria. I mean, really going for good health and promoting that. And Nathan liked being in public, Isidor not as much. But that's not to say Isidor also had a very important role. He served in Congress from 1893 to 1895, and was advisor to Grover Cleveland on currency reform and other financial policies. He was the first president of the Educational Alliance, which is a huge deal, and it also spent so much in improving the lives of Jews here in New York. But though you had Nathan playing such an active role with philanthropic causes, you needed somebody to run the business. And that's what was needed at R.H. Macy. And that's where Isidor really flourished. Now, we're going to jump back a little bit, because this is the man, Abraham, whose grandson said that his mother must have liked the word Abraham. Abraham is the Abraham from Abraham and Straus. Abraham had one, he was kind of like a real spitfire. He tried to run away from home and join the Union Army, he went to Chicago, and they had to bring him back, practically dragging him back, and they wanted to put him in retail, and he found a job with the Wexler brothers. He talked Joseph Wexler into investing $8,000with Abraham's $4,000 to open up a storefront in Brooklyn. And it was hard when you're writing a book in Abraham and Straus. You can't say Abraham and Straus was founded in 18... No, it's Wexler and Abraham. So you always have to say the store, the business, because it wasn't Abraham and Straus until 1893. Wexler and Abraham was such a drive... It defined Brooklyn. It was Abraham that really pushed for the elevated railway. It was Abraham that really spoke for the Brooklyn Bridge, even though people felt the bridge was going to get people out of Brooklyn, but it decided it went both ways. Bridges go both ways. And Brooklyn began to flourish. And it was Abraham that convinced Wexler to try out this kind of abandoned, beautiful building on Fulton Street and move the Fulton Street retail district. Now, those were some very ambitious goals. They were both big in philanthropy over there, just like the Strauses were over here. But it was really taxing Joseph Wexler. And it got to the point where Wexler and Abraham were not speaking in 1892. And Abraham went to find a partner. And this is where I needed to know what the Straus was in Abraham and Straus. He went towards Isidor and Nathan Straus. And the partnership fell apart between Wexler and Abraham, and that half ownership went to Isidor and Nathan Straus. They were not involved in the running so much of Abraham and Straus. they were still seen as the heads of R.H. Macy. They only had half ownership. They were seen as investors, but it didn't mean that Isidor wasn't looking at a lot of the sales reports and seeing whether there was inventory problems or cash flow issues. He still went after it, but it was still, he left Abraham running that store pretty much, and the Rothschild family. You'll see the Rothschild family, another wonderful strong Brooklyn retail public family over there. By 1898, off the top of my head, the Strauses did have full control over R.H. Macy. And that is when Isidor really brought his three sons into the business. That's Jesse Isidor, usually by Jesse Isidor, Percy and Herbert. Jesse Isidor even had his training at Abraham and Straus before he came over and to work at R.H. Macy. And all three sons, Harvard trained, became active in the management of R.H. Macy. Not at Abraham and Straus, that was still kept separate. R.H. Macy, you had Isidor, you had the three sons working there, and Nathan still involved as a co-owner, partner, but off doing public good for the most part. It's also a time where Wexler and Abraham, Wexler and Abraham, when it became Abraham and Straus on April 1st, 1893, it was nothing to shake a stick at. It was the largest department store building in New York by the late 1890s. So when R.H. Macy, and this is a very generous drawing or not of the R.H. Macy business in the late 1890s, they really had to upgrade. This is on 14th and 6th. And so they looked forward, they looked higher up, and they started acquiring business property in the 34th Street area. And it was a quiet area during the day, and there were some well-known, and they say high-end brothels at night, which is kind of, I don't know what that exactly means or whatever, but they decided that's the middle of New York, you have the trains coming through, you have Penn Station, which eventually shows up, this is where they're going to locate. And they do. And on November 8th, I'll jump back a little bit. Those are the three boys of Jesse, Isidor, Percy, and Herbert. But as we see, Macy's opening up into that building, which is on November 8th, 1902, a $4.8 million store with 33 elevators, 18 miles of pneumatic tubes, and 24 acres of floor space. It certainly overshadowed any of the competition. Now, in the purpose of getting everything in here, let's talk about today. Because it's the important with the anniversary, with the Titanic. And I'm not going to go and really can give you a full lecture on the Titanic, because that's the subject of movies, books, and other talks and whatnot. But it plays an important, important role in the Straus legacy and history. Isidor and Ida Blum married in 1871. Almost said 1870, but had to stop. And thankfully, Joan added a one right now because I started doubting myself. And they were inseparable. This is like the true love story. The family, a strong family. They traveled together. They were inseparable with that. And they went on a European trip, it says in January, I believe in 1902, for some respite, going to the French Riviera. They talk about looking to hire a French maid. And Nathan is also going abroad, and they're over there and decided that they're gonna come back. The boys are kind of minding the shop at R.H. Macy, and they come back on the new White Star Line, the RMS Titanic, on its maiden voyage, especially a great ship because it's unsinkable, and they were part of 2,200 passengers and crew. It was a relatively uneventful first 3 days of the trip, even though before it took off, it almost got a little unmoored, and there was a little incident early on. But those first three days, it went very smoothly, as we know, until what happened last night, right before midnight, 107 years ago. And initially, it wasn't a problem. And initially, when they made contact with the iceberg, people came forward. They said, "You can go back to your rooms." And then that's when we realized that it was something bigger and greater than that. Isidor and Ida were directed to Lifeboat 8, where they were to have safe passage. Isidor would not get on that lifeboat. And this is like the whole, with the people witnessing that, giving reports. Ida did not want to get on that lifeboat. She instructed her maid that she brought over, a British maid. They didn't end up having a French maid to get on the lifeboat in her place. And there's all these accounts, that I pulled out of sources to see like what was said and what was observed, and how she threw her arms around Isidor's neck half hysterically and refused to leave his side, saying, "We have lived together for many years. Where you go, I go." Also saying, "I have lived with you, I will die with you." Also saying, "We live together, so we shall die together." And that is what happens when Ida does not leave Isidor's side. And it becomes this immortalized story, this wonderful story and tragic story. There's reports saying that they were last seen holding hands on the deck. Last report saying they were both seated side by side on the deck. I'm sure there are other accounts that come forward, but those are the two that struck me as I was doing my research. The first information coming back from the Titanic, that they hear that there has been this incident, and the White Star Line reports that, what do they say? They say everyone is saved. That's what we hear. Then a little bit later, they learn that the boat is being towed to Halifax, and how the boat is unsinkable. Nothing but inconvenience will be suffered by the passengers. As we know, it turns a little bit worse than that. By 2:20 a.m., the ship did sink. 1,500 people perished. That included Isidor and Ida Straus. The Carpathia was nearby. Also on the Carpathia was a grocery buyer for Macy's. And as they are taking in survivors that they are picking up, he is looking back and forth, trying to see if Isidor and Ida were survivors, and they were not on that boat. And as the Titanic is coming back, Jesse Isidor with his wife are coming over to Europe. And he hears the news of the story, of the tragedy. By the time he gets to lands in Europe, that he learns that his parents did not survive. And I find it interesting that he turns around and he gets passage on the ship Lusitania to come back here, which just kind of... when they arrive, when New York learns that especially John Astor passes away, they also hear names like Benjamin Guggenheim, and then they hear about the Strauses. Now, the unfortunate thing for everybody was that you find nothing but eulogies, and the pages are full of remembrances and memorials. And unfortunately, Isidor and Ida don't really get their full due because there's so many people to memorialize. But certainly their story is heavily reported. There's memorial tributes to them. There's 6,000 people attend a Carnegie Hall tribute. And tributes come from all many service organizations, from B'nai B'rith, the Council of Jewish Communal Institutions, the Daughters of Jacob. You also have reports. This is from the ANS employees put this out and sent it to the Straus family. And in it, as I go back here, it says, "As their lives were examples of human goodness, so their death must remain as an inspiration. With the sorrow of their loss, there must mingle with us the exultation of having been in small part been associated with such a man and woman." Now, when I go through, and there's so many, Ida, what she did, that story became such a classic part of the Titanic story, but deservedly so. And this is from a national press wire. It was not, no one was credited with it, which I liked. Well, for the sentiment of it. "Mrs. Straus became immortal among men and women for all time to come. She will live in poetry, picture, and inspired prose as long as literature shall last. And her influence will be strong and sweet as long as the human heart throbs. You probably know, if you're a Straus, that the wonderful tablet that graced the 34th verse unveiled, Sarah unveiled it, right? And I loved watching the YouTube clip that was part of the Strauses story. It was your mother? Then I'm making another mistake with 1870. But that tablet there, that and went missing for a little while, but paid for by the employees. And we heard a little bit about, had the report on Straus Park, which is important. And then you have Nathan, because Nathan and Isidor were such partners. And Nathan was seen as a little bit more fragile than Isidor. And he had, they wanted to keep, he's over in across the ocean, they wanted to keep the news for him by doctor's and wife's orders that his brother had perished. And, you even read reports where, Nathan had some own personal struggles and that were even reported in the paper. But he has his two sons, Nathan Straus Jr. and Hugh Grant Straus. And the story goes that he wanted, here he is as the sole owner, though as Nathan, with Isidor's sons running there, that he wanted, Nathan wanted his boys to become involved in the R.H. Macy management. And there became a divide between the family. And to make a long story short, Nathan and his sons took control of the interest in Abraham and Straus and the L. Straus and Sons firm, and Jesse, Isidor, Percy, and Herbert took over control of the R.H. Macy firm. And at that point, they say that Nathan retired from business, but it was a real heartbreak between the two families. And they even report that they felt that, Nathan really kind of blamed Percy a little bit on putting a lot of pressure to sell the business, and he made him and said that he made his older brother made it impossible for him or his sons to remain with the corporation. And I do look through and I look at like any type of burial information or funeral information, and I don't see the two families attending one another's tributes. And that happens, and there could be strong dynamics and all, and but it's not to say that Nathan didn't continue doing his good work for many years, in addition to his son. And all of the two businesses thrived. Look, Abraham and Straus, you still had Nathan served on the as chairman of that board until 1924, mostly in a celebratory role there. And you have Straus Square, which is down there in Lower East Side. Abraham and Straus was nothing to shake a stick at when become of the popularity of a business that's the fourth largest department store building in the country, even though we know Macy's was being the R.H. Macy and Herald Square being the largest. It also was the set for 1929 when Federated Department Stores was basically conceived in the Long Island Sound with part of the Abraham family, along with Filene and Lazarus, and later joined by Bloomingdale. And it became a real driving force in Brooklyn and retail in general, second highest in sales in the city. But Macy's, it's kind of hard to not kind of credit what Macy's has done, with the business. They said by, here in 1929, when they call it the Christmas parade at that point, and how that became such a treasured feature of what they did. They did not have the first Thanksgiving parade or Christmas parade. That goes to Hudson's over there in Detroit, and the one in Philadelphia even precedes the New York parade. Macy's, just gonna go through a little bit here. It did try to expand. There was all these, both Macy's and Gimbel's did think about becoming a national organization, but you have to have members of the family in order that are active and wanna support that. They did, the person who was handed to run R.H. Macy was Jesse Isidor's son, Jack I. Straus. He was in charge of taking it through the next step through the 20th century. Yes, they made some expansions into Toledo, Atlanta, and Newark before they kind of regrouped themselves. I love this because these two buildings here, they're still in operation, and they were under part of Jack Straus's leadership. There, on the right, you have Macy's in San Francisco. Macy's in San Francisco became an experimental test store, basically to see what could work when Herald Square needed some help. They saw what was working at the downtown San Francisco store, especially the cellar, and transformed it over here into Herald Square, and became such a hit and reinvented Macy's. On the left is the Park Chester store in Bronx, built in 1941. It's still there. How many businesses are still there after almost 80 years as part of that contained complex? It's amazing to see it. I mean, if you are a department store nut or aficionado and have an interest with the Straus family and how they went forward and some of the visions they had, you could take the train to Park Chester. It's kind of fun. It's not far off in 95, too, so if you need to make a quick stop. Jack Straus made the cover of Time magazine in January of 1965. He talked about how he was kind of also, it was made a natural sense because at the age of two, he helped lay the cornerstone at the Herald Square store. I mean, in that article, he talked about the rise of discounting, which is affecting retailers, the flight to the suburbs, and inner city traffic, but he said Macy's had the new secret weapon, and that was the computer. And they were putting all their charge accounts on computer. And they were going to start adding a computer for merchandising, even to make it stronger. So as I kind of breeze through what I've learned and what I've liked, I really, yes, I am drawn to what we see there. I'm also drawn to what we see there. And going back to the other slide, which is of the Fulton Street store in Brooklyn. Now, we can complain about R.H. Macy in the sense that people see that the Macy's nameplate has taken over the country. Not so. Macy's, the last Straus member left the organization in 1986. And that was a time when there were mergers and buyouts and every type of executive turmoil. And to be precise, in 1994, R.H. Macy filed for bankruptcy. And it was purchased by Federated Department Stores, the owner in the long lineage of Abraham and Straus. Abraham and Straus takes over the Macy's nameplate because by consolidation, the cheaper way to handle things, the Macy's nameplate, especially by 2006, became a national force. Why I show these two stores is because here we are in 2019, and I look and think, as I said, about my mother driving us around the station wagon, going to all these different places, seeing all these different stores and names and cultures, and not minding it, realizing I was just spending time with my mom. There, I counted only 12 downtown department stores left in this country. 12. I have a trade journal from 1965. That lists 9 large department stores alone in the state of Alabama. And we're talking about stores that are at least of 300,000 square feet. Granted, Macy's is 2.1, but that's an anomaly. So here in the New York area, you have the store on Brooklyn, as smaller and downsized as it is, and you have this Macy's. That unfortunately makes you very unique. Hey, you lost Lord and Taylor. What was that about? That's a whole other lecture upon itself. But it shows you a little bit about the business. And there's people that bemoan about B. Altman. That's a whole other lecture in itself. See, look, everyone's going, yeah. That's why I'm writing these books, because people kind of hear these names. But you also hear about the Altman Foundation, the Gimbel Foundation. You hear about the good, the philanthropy that continues today, and you hear it with the Strauses. Hey, if you're ever walking around in that 13th, 14th Street area near 6th Avenue, check out Macy's. Parts of it are still there. You have it as far as the new school. And if you look up there, what fades over time are the red stars. This is on 14th Street. Yes, it's a Five Guys here, but that was one of the entryways into Macy's. That still stands. So these stores aren't really going to come back. That's the way things are. Things have changed. But it's really fun because every store has a story. I think everything Spain has a story. This clicker and all has. You could write a book about that. But it's really wonderful getting to know cultures, getting to know people and audiences. I never thought in a million years I'd be on CBS Sunday Morning or talking at the Boston Public Library or having BBC World America in my living room asking me about the future of Sears. That's a whole other story. And it's just been a real fascinating experience. And I thank everybody here at Leo Baeck and Billy and all for inviting me here and to talk a little bit and do a quick run through of the Macy and Straus family. And I really enjoy it. Thank you very much.
Michael, that was delightful, and I want to know how much you'd know about department stores if you didn't have a day job.
Well, it's amazing what you can do when you do. I mean, the TV is on at the house every day, all the time. It also calms the dog down, but it's wonderful to, because I have been in love with microfilm. I promised to let you speak, Paul. But I love microfilm, and I loved learning the stories as the stores went away, and you find the eulogies. And that's when the personal experiences and memories come out. And that's what brings these stores to life. Today, a store can open and close, and we don't even bat an eye. But at that point, these places were such institutions, and that's the passion that drew me to learning more about department stores. Don't get me started on supermarkets.
Okay, I won't.
Don't.
Paul, maybe you could say, maybe Michael missed something in that history. Or what important would you want to say about the Straus family history and legacy?
Well, I don't think Michael missed anything when it comes to department stores. But I think in terms of the Straus family, Michael beautifully captured the legacy of Lazarus and Sarah Straus. They were simply a remarkable couple who, as Michael indicated, came from Germany before the Civil War in the 1850s to America with their four children, settled in the South, and then came after the war to the North. And I think the legacy they left not only includes their success as entrepreneurs and very successful businessmen, but I think also it includes, very importantly, that they saw themselves as having responsibility to be civic leaders as well. There are many German Jewish families who came to America, many of whom's name you know. Many are embedded on banks and Wall Street firms. But I think that what makes the Straus family unique, the true one-of-a-kind definition of the word unique, is that in addition to becoming wealthy through their entrepreneurial ventures, I mean, what an incredible decision to move from their safe slot on 14th Street to what was then this unexplored, dark during the day, uptown location of 34th Street. What a brilliant but risky entrepreneurial choice that they made. But with all of that said and done, I think that Isidor, Nathan, and Oscar all felt that they were very fortunate to have been so welcomed to America as immigrants. All of them were born in Germany. Oscar, the youngest, came here at age 2. Isidor, the eldest, at age 9. But they were all of German heritage, welcomed warmly to America. And I think that's a message that we have to remember today, where the issue of immigration is on the front burner and the front pages of every social media, every major newspaper, and every television broadcast, that they were welcomed, they felt fortunate to have had an opportunity to immigrate to this great country, and perhaps most important of all, they felt that they owed America for what they had been given, and therefore took leadership roles. Isidor, by serving in the United States Congress on many commissions in New York State. Nathan, as a leader, is noted here, Parks Commissioner and Health Commissioner, setting up the pasteurized milk stations in New York and beyond, and then setting up the food pantries in what was then Palestine for those who were poor, and being a generous philanthropist to that emerging nation of Israel. And Oscar, in many ways, one of the most outstanding among the four children and the three brothers, as the first person of Jewish faith to become a United States ambassador, and he had to be confirmed, right, advise and consent, by the United States Senate. And here was a Jewish man in a Protestant nation being confirmed to be the ambassador to a Muslim nation, Turkey. Think of that in terms of 2019 and what we are working with. And then later appointed by Theodore Roosevelt to again be the first Jew to be a member of the presidential cabinet in the then combined cabinet post of Secretary of Commerce and Labor. They didn't make money that way. They gave back for what they had been given.
Just a little historical context. So Lazarus, brought his family over, and this would have been in the 1850s.
He came over in 1852,
Right. Saw
that this could be a successful experience, and then brought his wife and four children over in 1854.
Right. So just to expand on that, this was a large German immigration and German Jewish following the failed revolutions of 1848 in Germany and throughout Europe.
Exactly.
And just so people know that there was no country of Germany until 1871, and Jews were treated very differently depending on what part of the German-speaking lands they were in. And they often, when they came here, they considered it was called auto-emancipation because they were not emancipated in the German lands. And here, as you're describing, they had the opportunities to emancipate themselves and succeed.
And this country made that possible to strangers from across an ocean. Strangers who had no claim to be in America, but as immigrants, gave back to America more than they had ever been expected to give.
So maybe, Michael, I don't know whether you want to talk about something about immigration and its impact on the department stores, especially how it changed in the mass immigrations that came later in the 19th century. And who the department source served.
What I wanted to expand upon a little bit about Lazarus is that here you have in the Civil War, if you are a Northerner and the war is going on, you are not obligated to pay the debts, the Southern debts. They didn't really encourage that because they didn't want to bring the money down to the Southern states. But Lazarus paid back every debt. I mean, Lazarus did go from being a Southerner and embraced being a Southerner, even Isidor embraced being a Southerner with the trade that he was doing, but still, when they moved north, made sure he paid all of his debts, and that's what gave him clout within the business. That was something not expected. A lot of when businesses are started, and there was a real wave to bring families over, to bring, especially with German Jewish families, bring it, pay for them to come over. I live in Maryland, and one of the Heck department stores was one of the stores there, and one of the Hecks paid for a lot of the families to come over, members of the Heck family. But since Maryland's a border state, you didn't have to pay your bills, and you had some members of the family not paying their bills to each other. Lazarus settled all of his debts, and I think that speaks to his character.
Yes, there's a wonderful story. He comments upon it in his autobiography, and it's commented on in the biography that has been written about Isidor and his wife Ida by a noted historian, that at the end of the war, when the Southerners who were in merchandise came to settle their debts, and they had considerable debts because they had to buy from wholesalers on credit. Most of the wholesalers, when their creditors would come, would say, as they did to Mr. Straus, "Tell me, Mr. Straus, how much can you pay me back on the debt you owe me?" It would be 10 cents on the dollar, 20 cents on the dollar. Lazarus Straus said, "Sir, I will pay you back dollar for dollar. It may not be easy for me to do that, but it will mean that even if I don't have much currency left, I will leave my family and my children with a good name." And I think that's a wonderful story. Yeah.
And you're saying that good name really carried forward and made for success in,
well, sure,
in succeeding businesses.
Yes, and then establishing the business. I mean, I think going on that philosophy and then adopting some of these newfangled policies of trading, of everybody paying the same price, standing behind your merchandise. It wasn't something that the Strauses invented. Maybe you can look to some ideas, but they adopted it. So with the strength of their character and with the morals that they paying back those debts and then putting that in with their business, that helped make it what it is today. And they always thought bigger. They were something where they were always thinking big, and that's kind of helped make them who they were, because they were always thinking how we could expand things, and they were just a visionary family.
That ad you showed for the first Macy's parade wasn't,
yes,
the first. They didn't invent it. You say Hudson's and others did it. But was that in November of 1929?
November of 1924.
Oh, 24, okay. So
and I loved how it went by, yeah, Straus Park.
Okay, too. So I was curious thinking about, you didn't talk at all, I mean, because it wasn't part of your charge, the results of the Great Depression on the impact that it had on the...
Sure. I mean, the Depression and during the war when there are shortages, all of that does impact these promotions. But I want to say one thing in regards to department stores and what I've learned. But let's take the Macy's Parade as an example. That is, and or the fireworks. Let's take that for example. That is something that you all expect year after year. Just as you expected all those windows for whatever store you liked to be there, for whatever art expeditions, for whatever fashion shows, whatever special events that all these stores did for various reasons, whether it was part of their culture or to bring people in. And when they took that away, you all got mad. But you really weren't going there. You're at Corvettes half the time. But you, the department stores have this certain expectations. Macy's today, though it's not R.H. Macy, has an expectation of putting on that parade. They have an expectation with the fireworks. They have an expectation also with the world's largest store. And they're trying to reinvent and see where the industry's going. But that was always something like with the parade. They were able to pull it in Newark. Did you know Newark had its own parade? Same, Macy Company, but there was a Newark parade. but they ended up stopping it because TV became big. Now you're all watching that, there's an expectation, and that was very hard on some of these businesses, especially some of the smaller ones that were family run. Sorry, I just had to rant.
That's good. We have 15 minutes, and we'd love to answer any questions. I don't know, are you going to carry the mics away, or do you want people to come down to this? Okay, so raise your hand, and we'll bring you a mic. And we do have a lot of Straus family experts in the hall who can help. Sure, why don't we start here?
In the legend of the... It's on, I don't know. Yeah. In the legend of the Titanic, a lot of people were on that ship because of the celebrity of the ship and the maiden voyage, and it wanted to set a transatlantic record. Are you telling me that Ida and Isidor were fortuitously on that ship? There was no celebrity involved. They didn't want to be on that particular ship. I mean, Harry Widener was on the ship to bring a first folio back as fast as he could. This was just totally fortuitous.
I don't believe they were doing it for any type of show.
Well, this wasn't their first choice for the return, but they did want to get back. And they knew that with a serious coal strike in the United Kingdom, that with the limited coal, if there was to be one ship that would be insured to have enough coal to make the transatlantic voyage, it would be the Titanic, the great ship, the largest ship, the fastest, the unsinkable ship. So that's why they booked on the Titanic.
I've always been curious about the holdout building on 34th and 6th. What's the story with that?
They still don't own it, as far as I understand. That was kind of a, I don't know if you know, at the corner of 34th and 6th, there's that little, it's the Macy's shopping bag. And there's a whole legend behind whether a competitor, Siegel, from Siegel Cooper, wanted a part of it. No, I mean, it was just Macy really didn't want to pay the price for it. And at one point, Loft Candies had it for $100,000 a year as rent, for a 20-year rent. And it was just became a holdout where they lease it for signage. United Cigar Stores was in it. And it's still, they were able to build the store around that business. But to this day, they still do not own that corner property. They were going to build a 12-story building at one point, but it structurally wouldn't have stayed up. I mean, they've been known for that tiny little piece of lot.
I wonder if you can, is this on? I don't know. Speak a little bit about the employees of Macy's and the interaction with the management there. I think there were some things that were unique and kind of special.
Well, that's kind of a tall order. And what and it would have been a lot easier. I have this wonderful brochure from 1940 that outlines all 168 departments within that store, and who does the Bureau of Standards, all of the, I mean, a lot of department stores, let's say, a lot of department stores did have employee recreation and had support and social groups and also health care, like within the organization, as far as nursing and chiropodists on staff for sore feet, and some of the other investment opportunities. But the thing that gets me with Macy's was the grand aspect of it. The store was so big that the services there were just so extreme because of the physical size of the store. I mean, I don't know how many pages of individual departments that they had there that they went through. And so a lot of the stores did have these social opportunities for employees, but it's just the mammoth size of that business.
I was just wondering if the American concept of the department stores were based on the first, the Bon Marché in Paris, which was Emile Zola's, you know, it went worldwide with the book. And was that any influence on the American concept of the department store?
Sure, a lot of people do cite Bon Marché as being one of the real inspirations of it. And the concept that department stores really also played was the depth of merchandise, because you didn't have all, and that's where you look at the size of Macy's, you did not have all of that type, that the merchandise offered in one place before. That was more of the premise. I mean, there is no classic definition of a department store, but it was the depth of merchandise and having it in one place. Adopting the other policies of treating everybody the same. And I say that in quotation marks, because I know when you're in Baltimore and many other states, you have to be of a certain color to be on the main floor or above the department stores. And I think that, yes, they were modeled after that premise. If you want to go and see what the first department store that ever registered in America was, Zion's Cooperative Mercantile Institution, part a branch of the Mormon Church in Salt Lake City, ZCMI, that operated as such until, I think, 1999. It was a wonderful department store, but it had a strange mixture of Bibles and survivalist food. And it was taken over by a branch of the May Company. But that was the first company that ever registered itself, incorporated itself as such.
I have two questions. One, there's a picture upstairs in the photo collection of a guy pulling a cart full of different items, a lot of merchandise, with like labels on it. And it mentions that that's the genesis of the department store, is, you know, these guys pulling these carts. That, and so I'd like to know how that fits into this. And then my second question is, the term dry goods, what does that really mean, and what's the story behind that?
Dry goods, I'd have to, I wish I could give you the exact definition about why that was called as such. I mean, a lot of the dry goods places would look more towards laces and trimmings and ribbons. You would see that type of item being more, I'm sure there's a much clever way to describe it than what I'm doing it. A non-perishable, yeah. But that's kind of what was considered when there, because people weren't buying clothes, they were making their own clothes. And as far as, I mean, peddling, because, I mean, Lazarus Straus is one example. I mean, he's bringing merchandise that people did not have. And that's a department store delivered merchandise that people couldn't get. So, and you're learning your trade, you're learning the roots, and that was part of your custom that you brought over, that you knew what to do. You established your route, you knew your customer, you knew where that was, so you're basically practically bringing a department store with you.
So right, it's tradition. Could you pass it up, because there's people up top. There's a tradition where the peddlers came first, they were carrying it on their backs, then they got a cart, then they opened up a store, and then if they were very successful, they opened up more stores and expanded. It's a long tradition with the Jewish immigrants.
Abraham peddled throughout Brooklyn and Long Island.
No. Okay, keep going into the back, Steve. Let's get some people in the back, because we have 5 more minutes yet. And David, you can move back.
Yes, for Mr. Kurtzman. Is there anything else you can share about your great-grandmother, Ida?
Well, I think that's a wonderful question, because so often we speak of the men of the family, as I have, and after all we talk about Lazarus coming to America, but we have to really speak of the fact that Lazarus and Sarah, his wife, came to America with their 4 children. And in turn, when we're talking about Isidor, as you mentioned, his partner, Ida, who I think Michael very aptly portrayed as a true partner in all aspects of life. After all, she brought 7 children into the world. 1, Clarence, died in childhood, and the remaining 3 boys and 3 girls grew to adulthood, married, and had their children. but we seldom pause to take a look at what, in fact, Isidor Straus would have been if there had not been a very special person called Ida Straus, who also was an immigrant from Germany at a very young age. She was the bulwark of the family, and not merely the head of household, as we traditionally have used that term in the past, and obviously a doting mother for her children, but she was a life partner for Isidor. They were bonded. They gave to one another and shared in a way that doesn't happen in every marriage. And I think that this is portrayed in a wonderful biography that has been written. The title is Ida and Isidor Straus, with Ida being the first name in the title. And the subtitle is A Love Story. And that is available. You can buy it on Amazon or BarnesandNoble.com, or by going to the Straus Historical Society's website, where under publications icon, we have it available as well. It really records in great depth what I think is embedded in the spirit of your question, which is the significant but seldom told and appreciated story of Ida's role and her leadership in the family, and similarly, the important leadership role that the sister, Hermina Straus, later Hermina Straus Cohens, played. We have her great-granddaughter here with us, I know, today. But she was the warmth, the place that they all went in the city, and where Lazarus, in his elderly years, because he was blessed to live a very long life, spent many years in the care and the company of his loving daughter. And her role and the role of her progeny should also be recognized as well.
Well put. We have time for one more question.
I was wondering about maybe some contrast with, say, Stewart's department store, where Mary Todd Lincoln shopped, and sort of a part of more of maybe of a Protestant establishment. What did Macy's offer in its core competencies that might have been different?
Yeah, could you just repeat that as, yeah.
I'm sorry, I was thinking of Stewart's department store on Chambers.
Yes.
And being part of sort of the Protestant establishment, mm-hmm. where Mary Todd Lincoln shopped.
Yeah.
What did Macy's offer that was different? Were they similar at the time?
I guess what Macy's offered was that Stewart's failed before Macy's became what it was. Alexander Tierney Stewart, a lot of people will equate that as the founder of the American department stores and people coming up with these modern merchandising policies. That store was taken over by John Wanamaker, who was his mentor. So, but by the time that store fizzled out, Macy's was able to fill that void. You see in New York, too, that the higher the class, the higher the offering of stores, the higher up it goes geographically. So when Macy's landed in the middle at 34th Street, that's your middle class. The stores that went above there, the Saks and all, that was their higher classes. The stores that stayed in the lower Broadway area or 14th and below, that's not where the people were wanting to live. And that's why Stewart's down there at 9th and Broadway, which became Wanamaker's, was well out of the way. Now you got Kmart. There's a whole other lecture.
Well, I want to thank everybody, David, Al, Paul, and Michael, for a wonderful, wonderful presentation. The conversation can continue over reception.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.